questions. I'm Pooh, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, eager.
101.1 FM is owned and operated by the Independence Foundation Trust as a non-profit community service.
This is the Voice of Freedom. Listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network. You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight is Space Night, to boldly go where no man has ever gone before. You got that right. They just love to dig it in, don't they? And the sheep will just eat it up. Just don't understand any of the messages that they're getting. I wonder why that is. You see, I don't have a clue as to why that is, ladies and gentlemen. It's baffling to me. I don't understand how so many people can walk around all day with their brain in their shoes. It's amazing. I don't understand how I did it for so many years until I finally began to use my brain and put two and two together and found out it was really four instead of 36, like everybody was trying to tell me. Tonight should be fun. It should be interesting, I hope. And maybe even educational. Who knows? But I guarantee I'm going to make you think. Whether you learn anything or not, I'm going to make you think. Don't go away. I'll be right back, and we're going to be talking about the Roswell incident and something they call fragments of evidence. Welcome to Space Camp. When you get off the bus, pick up your little bags and go right into your little dormitory there and put on your spacesuit and meet me in the shuttle. The shuttle bus to Fantasyland, that is. This is an article that was printed in Nexus magazine. Nexus is one of these magazines that comes from Australia. And sometimes they print some good stuff in Nexus. Most of the time, however, it is full of the typical woo-woo, claptrap, way off the edge, crazy stuff. But for the random, really good stuff that comes along once in a while, it's worth subscribing to. And so we do. This article is called The Roswell Incident, Fragments of Evidence. Now, for those of you who don't know what the Roswell Incident is, let me sort of give you a little historical perspective here. There are some people who claim that in 1947, in July, an extraterrestrial disc-shaped spacecraft crashed in the New Mexico desert, and the dead bodies of extraterrestrial, I don't know what you'd call them, little alien dudes were found dead. Now, I have to tell you that when I was attached to the Office of Naval Intelligence, I saw top secret documents that said that this incident had really happened. However, since then, after many, many years of researching all of this stuff, I don't believe any of it happened. And I believe select people in the military services were shown bits and pieces of this, along with me, in order to help spread this story. For what better way, ladies and gentlemen, to end all wars forever and bring all humanity together in a one-world government than if we were threatened by some other species from out there on some other planet? What better way? Well, that's just about the best way you could come up with, and I think that's exactly what these people have tried to do, pull the wool over our eyes. And I think the whole space program was designed to prop it up. I don't think anybody would be ready to believe the existence of extraterrestrials on any other planet if we couldn't even get off our own, you see. I also think that they had to perfect some kind of technology in order to make the public believe that this stuff was true. And I think it's a combination of many things, many of which I've researched and found to be not only viable and probable, but at work on us as I speak, ladies and gentlemen. So, there you have it in a nutshell. I believe the whole thing was staged. I believe some people were allowed to see bits and pieces of this staged wreckage, which did not come from anywhere else but on this earth. And I think that there were some monkeys involved. Because the whole thing was monkey business, there had to be some monkeys involved. I believe they did some surgical intervention on the eyes, ears, and nose of some monkeys, amputated their tails, shaved them, and threw them in the wreckage, and just let people not really look at them, not get close, never touch them, but just get a little glimpse. And so over the years, in the minds of these people, their stories grew all out of proportion. And one of the problems with all of these witnesses who say they saw things is when you begin to investigate the witnesses and check out their stories, well, just about 90% of them fall on their faces every time. They don't survive that kind of scrutiny. And this article, The Roswell Incident, Fragments of Evidence, is another thing that has emerged. And it came from the... It emerged on the Art B.S. Bell show. Where else? Where else could it could never emerge here, folks, because I'd put it to a real test. And anonymity doesn't get you, or anonymity, whichever way you wish to pronounce it, doesn't get you anywhere here. You see, we have to be able to source and document everything. So somebody sends me an anonymous package and claims that it came from something or somewhere, and there's no solid documentation with it. You know where it goes? It goes in a big pile of that stuff that we have that never goes anywhere, because it's useless if we can't source it, if we can't document it, if we can't get signed, sworn affidavits, notarized. And that's what a certification is, ladies and gentlemen. Then it's useless. But not for Art B.S. Bell. Art appears Linda Moulton Howe, who wrote this article for Nexus Magazine. It's an analysis of metal pieces supposedly retrieved from a UFO crash near Roswell, New Mexico, and she says it confirms that their purity and composition are unknown to modern science. And that's a lie. That is just not true, ladies and gentlemen. Not unknown to modern science at all. For guess what this metal shows? It shows that it's as close to 100% aluminum as you can possibly get, and that it shows signs of having been manufactured in a zero-gravity environment. And they've had a scientist who's analyzed this, and this, that's what they say. And, I hate to pop all the bubbles of everybody out there who believes all this stuff. I just really do, but I have to. You see, this didn't surface until just recently. 1996, as a matter of fact. All of a sudden, this piece of metal shows up that's as close to 100% aluminum, or maybe it is 100% aluminum. It's so close they can't measure the impurities if there are any. And they say it was manufactured, the crystalline structure shows that it was manufactured in a zero gravity atmosphere. And it has, they have received some other pieces that are alloys. In other words, mixtures of aluminum and magnesium and some other things. And they're claiming that this proves that the Roswell crash occurred and that this piece of metal was manufactured in outer space by some extraterrestrial beings. Well, the sample was sent to Art Bell from an anonymous source who did not send a signed, sworn, and notarized certification or affidavit under penalty of perjury telling where this thing came from. Instead, he just sent a little note saying this came from the Roswell crash in New Mexico in 1947. Right then and there, you can't go any further. Because right then and there, you have a piece of metal that somebody sent. You don't know who the person is. You don't know if they're lying or not. But they take his word for it. They believe that it really came from the Roswell crash, this thing that arrived in a package in 1996 from an anonymous source. Sent to Art B.S. Bell, and these people believe it. Blight. That's what's wrong with all of this, folks. Too many Looney Tunes woo-woo freakos running around out there who believe anything that anybody tells them anytime they're told. And that's wacko. That's not the way you run a sane world. That's not the way you investigate anything, and that's not the way that you get to the truth of any matter. Right there, that is enough to discredit the whole thing. But let's go further. Let's look at the analysis and let's see if it really confirms that their purity and composition are unknown to modern science. Because I'm going to tell you, it's not only known to modern science, it was modern science that did it, ladies and gentlemen. And I know exactly when it was done. Let me get to the aluminum specimens. The first specimens were the aluminum ones, and the next specimens were the alloys mixed with other metals. The note that accompanied the first one said, "I followed your broadcast over the last year or so and have been considering whether or not to share with you and your listeners some information related to the Roswell UFO crash. My grandfather was a member of the retrieval team sent to the crash site just after the incident was reported. He died in 1974, but not before he had sat down with some of us and talked about the incident. Excuse me, folks, I had to turn down the mic and sneeze. I would have blown you all right out of your living rooms if I had not done that. He continues, "I am currently serving in the United States military and hold a security clearance and do not wish to go public and risk losing my career and commission. Nonetheless, I would like to briefly tell you what my own grandfather told me about Roswell. In fact, I enclosed for your safekeeping samples that were in the possession of my grandfather until he died and which I have had since his own estate was settled. As I understand it, they came from the UFO debris and were among a large batch subsequently sent to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio from New Mexico." There are several things wrong with this right off the bat, ladies and gentlemen. Number one is, if this had really come from a top-secret extraterrestrial spacecraft crash and the particles were taken to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, each and every single piece would have been cataloged, classified top secret, assigned a number, and placed in the custodial care of someone who every so many weeks has to go and take an inventory of every single piece and everything and make sure that it is there and accounted for, and nobody would ever be able to take, not even the smallest, tiniest sample ever. That's the way security classification and classified subjects are treated, and that's the way it works. If even the slightest piece of anything were to disappear, or all of a sudden turn up missing, somebody would be hung. And ladies and gentlemen, when it came to high security classifications of samples such as this would have been if it were really from an extraterrestrial spacecraft, I mean hung. So right there is a total fabrication. His father didn't take anything from Wright-Patterson Air Force Base that came from a crashed extraterrestrial spacecraft in his entire life, I can assure you. And we don't even know who this person is anywhere. He claims that he's an officer, because he's talking about doesn't want to lose his commission, in the one of the branches of the United States military. The analysis, ladies and gentlemen, of these small, connected, rectangular, one-quarter inch to a 10-inch long by 1.5-inch wide thin strip to one round piece nearly 3 inches in diameter and covered with circular grooves. There's also a series of small connected rectangular vents in which the slits alternated in opposite directions from one rectangle to another. Well, Art Bell contacted Linda Moulton Howe to see if she could get this analyzed. Why did he contact Linda Moulton Howe? I don't know. She's not a scientist. She's a reporter. Maybe that's why he contacted her. Get this immediately out in the news. And I'm sure he talked about it, at least on his radio show. And the tests, when they were finally performed, confirmed that the metal pieces were nearly pure aluminum. Nearly pure aluminum. And they say that, you know, this couldn't be done on Earth. And then they sent some second samples later. Much later. And this was on May 27th, 1996. A third letter, together with another metal shipment, was received by Art Bell. The entire letter is here. I'm not going to try to get into too much of this article. I want to talk about the stuff. The stuff. And Art Bell contacted Linda Moulton Howe again and said there were a half a dozen pieces about 2 inches long, about an inch wide, and averaging a quarter of an inch in thickness. And one side of each piece was dark, and the other side was a shiny silver. And Linda doesn't tell, this is another thing that's bad about this article, she doesn't tell us who analyzed these samples. She said she contacted a professor friend of hers who agreed to analyze the pieces. This whole thing, the whole UFO, so-called ufology community is exactly like this. Everything's anonymous. Nobody knows nothing, but it's all true. You see, to be able to believe this, you have to know who the professor was. What kind of tests did he do? Is he qualified to do the tests? Will he sign a sworn affidavit, notarized, certifying that he actually did this and that this is actually what the test showed? And was it done by somebody else in order to confirm his findings? Maybe three or four other people, because when you're dealing with something like this, you can't afford to take anybody's word for it. No, it's this anonymous university professor. On June 8, 1996, the university professor released his preliminary analysis. Remember, this is a preliminary analysis, so they always have an out. Have you ever noticed that? All these UFO stories, they always leave themselves a little out. And it says that these samples were different. The material was in two main pieces referred to as skins. Gives the size and weight of the samples that were tested. And each sample had a silvery, shiny side with a rough, granular appearance. The other side was blackish gray. Looking at the samples edge on, numerous layers can be seen, just like the quarters in your pocket. Maybe that's what they are. Alien funny money. What do you think, folks? Maybe there's a Confederation Reserve Bank out there somewhere. And maybe these are their version of debased coinage. Samples were hard but brittle, and a few small pieces could be broken off using a small hand vise and manual pressure. Energy dispersive spectroscopy, EDS, revealed that the shiny side contained more than 95% magnesium and a small amount, 2 to 3% of zinc. The dark side contained a significant amount of bismuth. The material appears to represent layers of a substance consisting mainly of magnesium and a small amount of zinc separated by thin layers containing a high bismuth content. How about that? On July 23rd, 1996, the anonymous professor released another more refined test report after applying wavelength dispersive spectroscopy, or WDS, to analyze the element composition of the metal skin. In his conclusion, he wrote, "The WDS confirms more quantitatively the previous EDS measurements. The material corresponds to layers of bismuth and magnesium zinc, with the weight percent of the zinc varying slightly from about 2.4% to 2.9% between bismuth layers. In addition, no zirconium could be detected with the magnesium zinc area. That search was because zirconium is frequently found in magnesium and zinc alloys." And they had questions about the isotope, they said. And they go on to say that the fragments exhibit the anti-gravity, as they call it, characteristics of having been manufactured in zero-gravity atmosphere. and they talk about the magnetic field and all of this kind of stuff. Bismuth's diamagnetism does not allow magnetic field lines to penetrate it. Bismuth also absorbs infrared energy, which could be converted to electricity. One tantalizing suggestion was that the bismuth magnesium material would provide anti-gravity lift when surrounded by a strong electrostatic force combined with a radio frequency signal, a Class C RF signal, though no specific frequency was given, and no scientific basis or data whatsoever is given for them to even mention such a thing in an article that is supposed to be scientific in nature. More BS thrown in for the woo-woo crowd, who will pick it up and run with it. And before long, just like the rock that they found in the Antarctic, which they said contained no life, and that they had found no evidence that it had ever contained any life, and then went on to say that it had little crystalline structures in it that looked like bacterium, and then began to theorize about life on Mars. The next day, the newspapers ran headlines saying, "Life discovered in Martian meteorite proves life used to exist on the planet Mars." That's the kind of science that we have today, ladies and gentlemen. BS. Crapola. And it doesn't come in a cereal box. And they go on to say that for some reason here, this thing demonstrated. And this science, folks, I called several people I know who are legitimate scientists, and I read them this portion, which they say proves it was manufactured in a zero-gravity atmosphere, and they can't even understand that it's even science. I mean, this is gobbledygook to them. They told me that this is absolute nonsense here, and so I'm not even going to read it to you because some nut out there will take it and run with it. But this is what they're saying. Now, I want you to go back and get all research. Research, ladies and gentlemen, all the articles you can find on the space station Mir and the experiments that were conducted in it and the space shuttle and the experiments that were conducted in the space shuttle and everything else that's ever been put up where they conducted experiments. And you will find... Now, I want you to do this so you'll know that I'm not telling you a fib, folks. I want you to do it so you'll know it's the truth. You will find, ladies and gentlemen, articles that go into extreme detail on how they manufactured 100% aluminum in a zero-gravity atmosphere in space. You'll also find where they were testing different types of energy collectors that could convert the energy of the sun into electricity. And you'll find that one of them was magnesium plates, thin magnesium and bismuth plates, and zinc plates separated by small layers of bismuth. That's why that this didn't turn up until 1996, ladies and gentlemen, because it didn't exist in 1947, it didn't exist in 1950, it didn't exist in 1960, it didn't exist in 1970, it didn't exist in 1980, and it probably did not exist in 1990. You get my drift? This stuff was manufactured by human beings at the edge of our atmosphere, in as pretty close to a zero-gravity environment as you can probably get. And it was manufactured by human beings in experiments to see if they could make better metals with a realigned crystalline structure that was not affected by gravity. Many of you who are science buffs will remember this. You probably have all the articles in your own possession in a folder in your file drawer because you collect this kind of stuff, just like I do. Art B.S. Bell knows this, and so does Linda Moulton Howe. By the way, the family Moulton and the family Howe are famous in the Masonic bloodlines. And I don't mean bloodlines of kings and queens of the House of David or anything else. I mean famous Freemasonic families. It appears that Linda Bolton married a Howe. And Howe. On July 5th, 1996, this is crazy, I mean absolutely nuts, on July 5th, 1996, Art Bell and Linda Moulton Howe received another and last letter communication from the anonymous source. The letter quoted allegedly from the deceased grandfather's journal about the layered material removed from the bottom side of a wedge-shaped vehicle near Roswell. Here's what it said. Sample extraction radiated light for a full 3 hours. Originally located on central underside of wedge-shaped disc. Speculate some type of shielding to enable craft and crew to survive accelerated entry into atmosphere. When craft was experiencing uncontrolled descent, pile of blackened ash was analyzed, and ash was confirmed of same elements of layering. Ash consisted of fibrous dust and residue. Ash and all debris swept into bagging. Bags placed in tagged boxes, boxes placed in the metal footlockers. Initial examination off-site conducted at New Mexico Institute of Mining and Technology. Secondary examinations at Los Alamos facility. Footlockers subsequently airlifted by courier to Wright Field, Ohio. So, these little pieces of magnesium and zinc layers separated by a layer of bismuth glowed for 3 full hours. Sorry, guys. I don't know who in the world is going to buy your bag of BS. But you know what they say? Baba, black sheep. 3 bags full. 1 for my master. 1 for my dame. And 1 for the little boy who lives down the lane. Well, I don't even think the little boy who lives down the lane will take it. What do you think? If you want to send your space junk somewhere, folks, send it to me. I'll give it real tests, and I'll tell you the real results, and I'll tell you who tested it and how, and we'll get it tested from several different sources, not just one. Oh, yes, we will. And don't send anything anonymous, because it'll be useless to us, because we can't take your word for anything if we don't even know who you are, and if you're not willing to stand by your word with a sworn affidavit. Unless, of course, you can send us anonymously an entire spacecraft or an entire alien, live or dead, I don't care. If you got those kinds of things, we'll take them even anonymously, but nothing else. Nothing else at all, ladies and gentlemen. With the modern genetic engineering going on, I wouldn't even accept the severed head of an alien. Who knows what it really could be? Who knows what those Nazi doctors are doing in Los Alamos National Laboratory in the Genome Project and in many other black projects hidden in the recesses of caves and caverns and underground facilities and behind the fences of the National Security Act and secret laboratories. You want to believe these clowns? If you do, I'm telling you right now, you're not playing with a full deck.
final frontier. These are the continuing voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Her ongoing mission to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life forms and new civilizations, to only go where no man has gone before.
There's more, folks. There's another article in here, and there's books and articles all over the place on this subject. Remember, one of their goals is to destroy all existing religions. What if they could convince you that God didn't make man? Extraterrestrials made man. They've even approached some ministers and priests and churches, and they said, oh, it wouldn't change anything because it was God that sent them to do it, is what they said. This really gets way out, folks. Really way out. Here's what it says. Are humans the engineered product of flesh and blood gene genies rather than an accident of evolution? Were we visited in our ancient history by the benevolent space brothers who came here to mine the earth? And did they create humankind? Did they create a race of slave workers who eventually broke out and escaped and learned to use their mind? Or were we taught to be civilized from the beast state by these extraterrestrial visitors? Are they the ones who came down out of the sky and mated with the women of the human race and bred a race of giants? This is all all of the speculation that runs rampant in these things. And you would be absolutely amazed at the circulation of these magazines and how many people buy these books and just blindly believe it. Why would anybody blindly believe this stuff without any research or any proof, just because somebody says it? And that's really what it boils down to, folks. There is no evidence anywhere with anyone of any kind whatsoever that extraterrestrials exist or have ever existed. And there have been several $1 million rewards offered for anybody who could produce the slightest shred of evidence, and there's a $1 million award being offered right now. And they'll pay it. Yet with all of this stuff about extraterrestrials, and all of these people who absolutely know that extraterrestrials exist, there's not one person who can come forth with one shred of evidence to claim that $1 million. See, if I could, I would. Wouldn't you? And I've read all of the research. I've read all of the papers. I've read all of the books. I have a library that you wouldn't believe, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm telling you right now, there is nothing. Nothing. UFOs are real. UFO means unidentified flying object, and there's plenty of those every day. You can look up in the sky sometime during any day and see something up there that you can't identify. And that's an unidentified flying object if you can't identify it. There are secret projects that have produced a super secret technology that has been put into the aviation field. And I have watched these things fly And if you were one of these woo-woo Looney Tunes people, you would believe the moment you saw it that it came from Mars, or Zeta Reticuli, or the star system of the Pleiades, or anywhere else but Earth. But let me ask you something, folks. If your TV were to break in your living room, would you immediately rush out, buy a plane ticket, and go to New York City to find out what's wrong with it? Or would you calmly walk across the room and look to see if it's plugged in? You see, that's what I would do. And if it was plugged in and it still wouldn't work, I would go and check the circuit breaker. I wouldn't jump in a plane and go to New York. And if it still didn't work after I checked the circuit breaker, then I'd call the local TV repairman. Because the darn TV set's in my living room. Ain't got nothing to do, folks, with New York. And where are all these flying saucers at? And all of these UFOs and all of these things that people can't explain, where are they at? Why, ladies and gentlemen, they're flying around in our atmosphere. If they're flying around in our atmosphere, why in the world are we hopping on a spaceship and flying to the Pleiades star system to find out where they came from? Can you tell me that? Because they're flying around in our atmosphere, don't you think the most logical and most probable source of these things is right here on this earth? I can tell you absolutely unequivocally, with 100% certainty, that at least some of them are. Because I can take you out in the desert in Nevada and show you exactly where they came from. And if you're lucky, you'll even get to see one fly. If you're not lucky, you won't, and you'll go away skeptical, and you'll say that I'm crazy and all of this other kind of stuff. And you should be skeptical. Everyone should listen to everyone, read everything, believe absolutely nothing unless they can prove it in their own research. And that goes for me. Goes for your mother. Goes for your school teacher, your preacher, your priest. Especially William Jefferson Clinton and all other politicians who prove themselves every day to be chronic liars. Without exception. There's not one politician in office anywhere who has not told a lie to his constituents. Usually they tell most of their lies while they're running for election. And then they sprinkle a few over their term just so they keep in practice for the next election, where they pull out their big book of lies and really go to him. You all know that. This is truly, ladies and gentlemen, the age of deception. The age of deception. They want a one-world government. One of these nights, I've done it before, I have to do it again because I think we have a lot of new listeners. I'll have to read to you from the report from Iron Mountain, the possibility and probability of permanent peace. And it outlines all of these deceptions in there and tells exactly why they would practice these deceptions in order to create their world government and how it would work and what it would do for the population. The whole works. And I've read verbatim from the book on this broadcast on, I think, a couple of occasions, at least once, in depth. And gave you the title and the author so that you could go find it. And many of you did, I know, because I got letters from you. People find it hard to believe that these kinds of deceptions could be taking place. Yet when you get up off your fanny and begin to look at these things with the simplest and most benign critical eye, and when you begin to ask the easiest, most basic questions that usually come right out of a high school physics or chemistry or science book, or all three for that matter, all of this stuff falls apart. All of it. NASA has turned out to be one of the biggest pack of liars that's ever existed in history. And we've already given you the membership of most of the people in management and some of the scientists who were connected with NASA and the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, along with Jack Parsons. They all belong to the OTO, the Temple of the Golden Dawn, it's amazing. They used to have Aleister Crowley parties each year, the anniversary of his birthday. Robert Anton Wilson would show up. The craziest things would happen. Jack Parsons' wife to this day claims that he was murdered. Wonder why they would murder old Jack Parsons. He's one of the founders of the Jet Propulsion Lab, ladies and gentlemen. He is one of the foundation stones upon which the space program rests. Are humans the engineered product of flesh and blood gene genies rather than an accident of evolution? You notice they don't put the other one in there. They don't say anything about being created by God. They're talking about being created by extraterrestrials. Remember, they want to eliminate all nation states, all existing religions save theirs, and they want to shackle the mob. How do you do that and get everybody to go along with it? Well, I can tell you, if you could float a large flying saucer over the city of Los Angeles, New York City, Washington, D.C., Paris, London, Beijing, Moscow, that would just about do it. You wouldn't even have to show them an extraterrestrial, but just to make sure that it works, because there's people like me around, with all the cloning and genetic engineering that they've been doing, I'm sure that in some laboratory deep in the recesses of some underground installation somewhere, they are feverishly trying to put some genes together from different animals and people to make some kind of an intelligent-looking, talking extraterrestrial being that they can present to the public of the world and tell them it came from outer space. Do I know that for a fact? No. Nope. I just know what my research tells me, and my research tells me that there has been a plan to try this for, well, at least 80 years, ladies and gentlemen. Because in 1917, John Dewey said this at a dinner for the visiting Imperial Japanese delegation headed by Viscount Ishii. He said, and I quote, "Someone once told me that the best way to end all wars forever and bring all humanity together in a one-world government would be if we were attacked by some other species from some other planet." I believe the radio broadcast by Orson Welles in the Mercury Theater was a test of that hypothesis to see if it was viable. Would people believe it? And they did. The next step was to create the technology to make it come true. And that's what they've been doing. The only reason a flying saucer hasn't landed on the White House lawn yet, ladies and gentlemen, is they don't have anybody to walk out of it yet. Give them a couple more years. Or maybe just a couple more months. And they will have. When that happens, watch out. Because if they got here across the vast reaches of space, that means they're so technologically advanced ahead of us that they would represent a clear threat to the Earth and all of its inhabitants. And a call would go out for all borders to come down and all nations and all peoples to unite in order to face this external threat. And then they would want to disarm all the peoples of the world, because they would be afraid that if one of these spacecraft landed on a peaceful mission, for instance, in Waycross, Georgia, some redneck dude might shoot them, and that might start an interplanetary war. This is exactly what they're going to tell us. Exactly. And so everybody will disarm, and they'll disarm their neighbors, because who would want to take the risk of keeping silent about the gun that his neighbor failed to turn in? Because it's not just risking his neighbor, it's risking the whole planet and all the people on it. Boy, George Carlin could really go crazy with this, couldn't he? He could give us 3 hours of hilarious laughter with this scenario. Maybe he's listening. Maybe he will. But if he wants to, since it was my idea, he can have it. Don't think they don't listen, folks. A lot of very famous people listen to this broadcast and have been for a long time. I get letters from them. They come and visit once in a while. It doesn't matter who they are, because they're just people like everybody else. But they do listen. Not everybody is enamored by the BS. A lot of people really want to know the truth. They want alternatives. They want to exercise their mind. They want somebody to make them think instead of feeding them mush all the time. Nothing but mush. Mush, mush, mush. And now, guess what? We have hardware on the ground on Mars, they tell us. Do you believe that? I can't believe it, because so much of what they told us in the past has been a lie. Unless I could go up there and see it for myself, I just can't believe what they tell me anymore. But now they tell us we have hardware orbiting the planet Mars. And folks, you can stand by, I'm telling you right now, you can stand by any day now for some kind of a photographic release or an announcement that they've found anomalous structures or material on the planet Mars that may be the remnants of an ancient civilization. How much you want to bet? I've been telling you this was going to happen for years, and I'm telling you right now it's going to happen. That's what they're going to tell us. They've got to tell us that. If they want their one world government, they've got to make you believe it. They've got to create the threat from space. They've got to make it real to the common man. And if they can't, they're going to turn out to be the laughing stock of the universe. They already are in some circles. They are here. If it wasn't for the great amount of disgust we have for their lies, we would be rolling on the floor constantly with laughter and derision. I've caught them in so many lies, it's not even funny. I remember being on a radio show in the San Fernando Valley way back in 1989, and I was talking about what I had seen when I was with the Office of Naval Intelligence concerning documents that stated that extraterrestrials were real. And I was calling these things into question, and I was calling NASA into question, because they said that they had lowered the Martian probe to the surface of Mars with a parachute. And I believed that, you know, just like everybody else, until I started studying what they told us about Mars and found out that the atmosphere of Mars can't support a parachute. Unless it was a couple of miles in diameter. And if it was that big, then the spaceship could never have lifted it off from Earth to take it there. And James, oh, I forget his last name. He was the spokesperson for NASA. They called him up right on the phone and asked him if that was true, that NASA had said that they had lowered the Martian probe through the atmosphere with a parachute. And he blatantly lied on the air and said, no, that man, Mr. Cooper, is lying to you. We never said that. But that's exactly what they said, folks, and it's in every NASA publication about the first probe that we sent to the planet Mars. And you can go to your library and get those NASA publications and read where they say that it was orbiting Mars, and then they turned on the rockets to tilt it into the atmosphere, and as it fell into the upper atmosphere, it deployed a parachute. And the parachute slowed its descent down through most of the atmosphere. The problem with that is the upper atmosphere of Mars is the thinnest place, and it couldn't support a parachute carrying that kind of a payload even in the thickest part of its atmosphere. Don't you get it, folks? And then I was looking at a NASA publication, and it showed their design for a Martian airplane that they were going to send to Mars in a rocket ship. And when it got there, it would be orbiting, it would be deployed into the atmosphere, and then these wings would open up and it would glide through the atmosphere. Absolutely impossible. Could not happen. Unless that airplane was the biggest mother of all airplanes that ever could be imagined in your entire life. Because it would have to have huge, gigantic wings and a very small body in order to be supported in the Martian atmosphere by an airfoil. There are some people who say that even then it's doubtful that it would work. Yet there it is in the NASA publications. It's right there, folks, for all to see. They're not only pulling our legs, they're pulling our arms, they're pulling our heads off. And they probably sit around the table every night and laugh at all the stupid suckers, the cattle they call us out here, the idiots, the nation or world of people who will not use their intelligence, that are no better than animals who do not have intelligence and so are beasts of burden and stakes on the table by choice and consent. That's what they think of us, folks. And you know what? Most people prove them right on a daily basis. Good night. God bless each and every single one of you. Buckle up.
Coffee? Tea? Would you like a pillow, sir? Oh, no! Oh, no! It's those nasty Klingons clinging on to the old way.
I'm sorry, Captain, but that's not logical.
Thank you. Look there. Out the spaceport.
What is it, Captain?
It looks like me, staring back at myself.
Gee, Captain. Maybe you're God.
Spock!
I'm sorry, Captain, but that's really not logical.
Spock, take the wheel. I've got to go to the bathroom.
That's the first logical thing you've said all day, Captain.
You're listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network.
Fella who lives down the block, his elevator don't go quite to the top. Works out at the Mega Mall where everybody shops. He's a